Hello, everybody. Good evening. Welcome to The Cutting Room in New York City. I am Brad Talinsky with BackStory, and tonight we have a really great event. We are welcoming the great Robert Cray and Steve Jordan. Robert's got a new record out, Robert Cray and the High Rhythm. And speaking with them is going to be Alan Paul, the author of the Allman Brothers book, One Way Out. And anyways, without further ado, let's bring the guys on.
Hello.
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 Hey.
Robert, Steve, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having
Pleasure.
Us.
Pleasure.
And so the occasion of doing this today is a new record featuring, it's in your name.
It's got my name out front.
And Steve produced it and played the drums, and it's called Robert Cray and the High Rhythm Section.
Right.
So tell us a little bit about who the High Rhythm Section are. First of all,
High Rhythm Section is, well, they are. We had three members of the High Rhythm Section on this record. Charles Hodges playing organ and piano, and Leroy Flick Hodges playing bass, and Archie Turner, also known as Hubby, playing the Wurlitzer and the clavinet. Steve Jordan played drums. And the High Rhythm are the guys who recorded on High Records out of Memphis at Royal Studios, and who backed up people like Al Green and Otis Clay and Syl Johnson and Ann Peebles, O.V. Wright, and on and on and on. So that's who they are.
Did you have a relationship with these guys before recording this record?
I had met a couple of the guys in the past, but just briefly.
Yeah. So is it hard to stay focused on working? Or do you want to sit and go, hey, you know that organ part on Love and Happiness? That was...
No, it wasn't hard to stay focused. It was pretty cool being in that studio because that's a place that hasn't changed since Willie Mitchell put it together when he finally got it fine-tuned when he was doing the Al Green records.
And Steve, as a drummer, I mean, you call it the High Rhythm Section, but I mean, there's no rhythm section without a drummer. So is it challenging or exciting for you to fit in with those guys who have such a thing together and become the backbone of it?
Well, I love the two drummers who played in High Rhythm, the great Al Jackson Jr. and Howard Grimes. Howard Grimes is still alive and well and playing great. It just so happens that week when we were recording, he had pneumonia. So I had to play the whole record. I was planning on splitting the duties because...
I don't think Robert's buying that.
I had to play.
Yeah. You know, but yeah. I was looking forward to playing with the band, obviously, but I didn't want to, it was only right to have the person who really... Of the two drummers, Al Jackson Jr., of course, created a sound, and not only did he have a landmark, groundbreaking sound with Booker T and the MGs and all those Stax records, but then he worked with Willie in creating the sound that became synonymous with Al Green and Ann Peebles at High Records, which was... All that stuff was recorded at Royal Studios. So I played the role of those two, and we had just lost Teeny Hodges about a year and a half ago, or more now. And, of course, Teeny Hodges was the guitar player in High Rhythm. So Robert played the part of Teeny Hodges, and I played the part of Al Jackson and Howard Grimes.
So for both of you guys, had you listened to enough of that music that you just... would fall into the roles of playing similarly to Teeny, similarly to Howard Grimes? Or do you study it, or do you not worry about it and just play like yourself?
You just play like yourself, you know. And we went into the studio, and the whole idea was to have it as a band instead of, you know, Robert Cray and some backup musicians. It wasn't like that. It was a band effort. Everybody participated in the construction of the tunes, and we went about it that way.
Steve, you feel the same way in terms of the drumming? Did you study, you know, those guys' parts before
you
played? Well,
I grew up listening to Al Jackson Jr. And I had the opportunity to play as a teenager with two of his cohorts, Steve Cropper and Doug Dunn. I was always reminded of what he did through them. Mm-hmm. And because I was listening to Stax records when I was 8 years old, and yeah. So that was a heavy influence as playing. Like Benny Benjamin was an influence on me, or Clyde Stubblefield, or Ringo Starr, or Tony Williams, or Charlie Watts, and the list goes on and on. So I'm very cognizant of his playing, and it's a benchmark type of thing. And in fact, several years ago in the 90s, and I produced a Booker T and MG's record, and I played in the MG's for a short period of time, so that was always there. But the whole idea of Robert playing with high rhythm was, I think of Robert as a great singer. We all know him as an incredible guitar player, but to me, what stands out to me even more than his unique and groundbreaking playing as a guitar player is a singer. So his favorite singer, or one of his favorite singers, is Ovie Wright. So, well, what was the band who played with Ovie Wright? Well, it was High Rhythm. Well, that's like, wow, if we put Robert Cray together with High Rhythm, boom, you know, like, that's going to be something. So that was the idea there, you know, but it wasn't like Robert playing the role of Teeny Hodges, because we want Robert to be Robert. You know, we were just going to support him in the role of a band, a real band, yeah, contributing. Yeah.
And this is actually released on your label, right?
That's right. Megan Voss and I have a label, JV Records, and distributed by MRI Distribution. And, you know, Megan and I have a band called The Verbs, and we put out our records on JV. And we wanted to not just expand, but for my production career, unless you're working for a fairly big size, a large label, you don't really get the support that you need to put together a campaign for people to hear your record. So I love working with Robert, and I knew that I wanted to make another record with Robert, but I didn't want to make a record with Robert and have nobody hear it, you know, which happened on the last record we did with the 40 Days and 40, whatever we called it. But it was like we put a lot of hard work into the record, and like nobody knew it came out. I said, well, that's ridiculous, you know. So we're like, okay, I know what it takes to, what the kind of money we need to make the record, and and the kind of team to put together to let people know we've made the record. All we have to do is make a really good record, and then maybe people will hear it. And so that was the idea behind it. And the idea behind JV Records is to sign artists who, for one-off, we do one-off deals. So we don't tie you down to 2 and 3 records like everybody does. We don't do 360 where we take your eggs and testicles and everything else. We just had one record for us, and we'll make a friendly deal, and we'll give you some nice money, and then we'll do our best to get it out there for people, and you'll make a record that you will really love, and I'll produce it, and Megan and I will A&R it, and like that, and it's all in-house, and you're a participant, it's a joint effort, and it has worked, because first of all, we made, if I don't say so myself, a wonderful record. Like, I enjoy listening to the record. It's fun to actually like to listen to something that you've done, because it doesn't always happen. So that's cool. And to get all the positive response we've been getting, and And from Billboard number one blues record, the first week it comes out, to, you know, to Wall Street Journal reviews and all kinds of stuff, and all the attention has been very positive. And we weren't trying to make a retro record. This is not a retro record. This is, these people are alive and well now. The studio is vital and active now. This is the way we play now. These are the songs we are playing now. And so this is, so it may have this, you know, the sensibilities of something classic, and that we don't run away from, but it's not an attempt to go back 30 years, 40 years to live in the past. This is, we're not living in the past.
Robert, Steve was saying that he wanted to make a record that really highlighted you as a singer, and that was, you know, his first thought about you.
No, I don't separate them. They're both, they go hand in hand. And
you're playing, if you will. I've always thought that. I don't know. Is that a,
that's just what happened? Well, I mean, that's how I understand, and that's the kind of music that I love listening to. I love it when a saxophone player, you know, does something, and you're listening to him, and he's telling the story, or she's telling the story. Piano player doing the same thing. That's the kind of music I like listening to. Somebody who's talking to you, telling you their story. So that's how I like to approach a solo or singing. And that's the kind of music I enjoy listening to.
How essential was this high rhythm and Stax? I mean, the Memphis soul music. How essential was it to you and your development of your own music?
It's pretty deep, because I mean, just like Steve, I've listened to this music forever, you know. And I was just talking to Steve about this whole thing anyway with the high rhythm section. Ballads are very difficult to do. Those people know how to do it. You can do a slow song, and it's not like it's just there. It's got motion, it's got feel, even if it's just tail-draggingly slow, you know? And that's a hard thing to accomplish. And that's one of the things that, like Steve was mentioning, Willie Mitchell raised those people at young ages and taught them how to do things like at the end of a phrase. I mean, just like magic. When I go back and listen to the record now, I still hear things that I didn't hear what they were doing when we were making the record. Finishing off the statement at the end of a phrase, starting at the top of the next one with something that just put a beautiful color on the top, and all that helps you to do what you have to do, whether it's playing a solo or if you're singing. It just like lifts you, right. You know.
And I'm going to assume none of that stuff's ever discussed, right?
It's not. It's just there. They know that. Yeah.
And you were talking about, I forget, one of you said that the room is exactly the same.
Yeah.
So what is it about these rooms? I mean, like the Motown, the Room, Sun Studios, the Room, Capricorn Records. I mean, is it the players more who are playing in the room, or is there really something about the...
It's a combination. It's a combination. In that room, it's a small room. Willie Mitchell tuned it years ago. There's a story we like telling, because I saw it happen myself. We came into studio one morning, and Charles Hodges sits at the Hammond, and he starts playing. He's got his headset on, and he's playing. And he can tell something's not right. Hey, somebody move the microphone on my Leslie. Comes back, the voice comes back from the control room. No, nobody moved it. Yeah, somebody did. I can tell. Organ's been in the same place for the last 40 years, I can tell. and sure enough, somebody had moved the microphone just the slightest bit. The players play a big part in the room that they're accustomed to, and the room has its sound that was, in that case, was built around, you know, they go hand in hand. The musicians were groomed, the room was tuned, and they're the people that are supposed to be in there, in that room, making that music. And that's the sound that you hear on all those records. by all those artists.
Yeah, and Willie Mitchell was a mastermind of the whole thing, because he had, you know, if you go back, and I'm in the process with Hart Perry of making a documentary on Willie Mitchell and his genius. And, you know, if there was no Willie Mitchell, no Stax, you know, that's basically how it goes. He actually created a sound in which the young players at Stax kind of heard, and they were like, wow, what is that? You know, you know, even Elvis Presley used to have Willie Mitchell play his private parties. You know, Willie Mitchell was the thing. And so when he started working at Royal Studios, you know, he had made a record that he thought was going to be his when he was working for High Records early on, when High Records was more of a rockabilly label before it became an R&B label, or at least, you know, generating most of that music. He made a record, and it ended up being a Bill Black combo record. So he actually, his first record ended up being a million seller for Bill Black, who was the bass player for Elvis Presley. You see, so it's all intertwined. So here you have the great Willie Mitchell actually cutting a record that he thinks is his, and then it comes out Bill Black record, and it's like, it's a million seller for Bill Black. And he found out about it when he was like in a store, and he heard a record, and it was called Smokey's something, whatever. And he's hey, that sounds like my record. And then he calls Joe Coogie and says, you know, and he said, yeah, well, we had to put it out on Bill Black because he's the famous guy, but you know, you'll get your chance. It's like, wait a minute, what are you talking about? And you know, and so it starts from there, and then, you know, Coogie gives him the label eventually, and he develops the whole sound because he is, number one, not only just a composer and a producer and an arranger, but he ends up engineering as well. So he tunes the room to get the sound he wants, to make the records he wants, and then he grooms the players to play what he wants them to play in the room that he has
right,
tuned.
I love the whole concept of tuning a room.
Right.
It's a great, it's, you know, it's kind of heavy. Do you make a differentiation in your own minds between rhythm and blues and blues? Is there a line, or is it?
I don't like to do that. It's a hard, it would be a hard thing to draw, you know?
And certainly in your career, you know, that melding has been there from the very beginning. Right. And then, you know, Albert King recorded a lot of his best tracks with Booker T and the MGs.
Exactly.
And Albert King recorded your song Phone Booth.
Yeah.
So was that a big thing for you?
Oh, man, it was cool, man. Albert King recorded my tune. Yeah, I was happy about that. Yeah, that was really cool. Yeah.
Was that, for each of you, was that a big thing? You both had some pretty good success at a young age. Judging by how young you look, maybe you guys were like 12 when you started. But was it a big deal for you to be accepted by some elder statesman that you looked up to, like Albert King?
It was great. You know, when it's just great. I mean, just to have somebody invite you into their world, somebody that you have a lot of respect for, and will give you an opportunity to either, you know, open or sit in or something like that. It's a great feeling.
And speaking of elder statesmen, you know, we need to pay a tribute to Chuck Berry, who we lost recently. And I mean, you guys actually met originally working on Hail Hail Rock and Roll, right? Is that right?
Right.
So I'd love to get some insight from each of you on the making of that. Getting ready for that concert, and tell me something about it.
The thing for me was great because I was a new kid on the scene, and it was like Chuck was like, "Would you like to have coffee, Robert?" And yeah, we'll have coffee, and I would watch Keith Richards, you know, being there, wanting to pay tribute to his hero, and his hero being really self-protective, even to the point of, you know, really getting mad at Keith, which, but I don't know if it was a love-hate thing or what. I mean, it's just like,
totally.
I think
totally.
Well, there's a lot of stories about Keith getting the brunt, but did any of that ire from Chuck go to you, or you, or was it all just focused on Keith, or did everybody catch some?
I think that, well, like I said, I was a new kid on the block. I got royal treatment in a sense where he didn't have anything on me or something, I don't know. Because there was a whole lot of things that happened. We were there forever. How long were we there? Rehearsing a week or something?
Like a year.
And right the day of the show at the Fox Theater, I'm sitting next to Eric Clapton, and we get past our lists for the show. And my list has more songs than what I rehearsed. And Eric's has less songs than what he rehearsed. Eric was really pissed. But then it got changed before the show. But Chuck had done that on purpose for whatever reason. I don't know.
Do you think he always intended to switch it back and he just wanted to mess with it?
Yeah, he just liked to mess with people. Yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty wild. The whole thing was incredible, actually. I don't know where to begin, but yeah. One of the great things about it was getting to work with Johnny Johnson. Yeah. And that was Keith's main objective, to not only pay tribute to Chuck Berry, but to pay tribute to Johnny Johnson and to tell the story.
And if I can just interject, I'm sorry, he had been sort of forgotten at that point, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, that was the beginning of him coming back.
Exactly. But he had been completely forgotten. And Keith was very cognizant of that story coming out. And he wanted that. He wanted to not only play with him, but tell the story of how it was Johnny's band, and then Chuck joined it, and everything. Which is the reason why you have a lot of these songs in piano keys instead of guitar keys. You know, there's no open A and open E on these songs. These are C sharp, E flat. All, you know, just, that's where the piano keys. And so that was important to tell that story. And then, as soon as Johnny Johnson started to play, everybody was, holy cow, this is, wow. You know, because, you know, if you didn't get a chance to play with Roosevelt Sykes or Fats Waller or anybody, you know, you don't really know what that's supposed to feel like. I mean, the closest thing to that I had felt before that was playing with Dr. John and playing with Richard T. You know, those geniuses, you know. But when Johnny started to play those songs, the way he played those songs, it was a whole new ball game. And that was part of the story that Keith wanted to tell. And to get them together again, because Chuck hadn't played with Johnny in years. And Chuck had forgotten his genius. That was part of Keith's storytelling as well. You know, for years, Chuck had been going from town to town, state fair to state fair, picking up bands, picking up local bands with a bag of cash. And if he liked the band, he'd give $1,000 back in cash to the promoter so he could pay the band. And he started to morph the tunes together so they were all just one big Chuck Berry song. And you couldn't tell what was what. You know, it would just go from one to one gigantic medley. And then Keith's thing was like, let's go back and listen to the genius of these records and the actual forms and the work you put into making these things so incredibly unique and groundbreaking. And that's what we did. And we were surprised every day by Chuck's genius about how he did this stuff. He was very, very, he wrote these great songs, and they were great arrangements, and they were his. And we've refamiliarized him with his own genius. And that was part of the thing that he was coming to terms with as we were making the film. So you have a guy who's kind of insecure about how the world is seeing him, you got to realize that institutionally he was kind of blackballed at the height of his success, like a lot of people around that time. They tried to stonewall Little Richard as well. You know, he put his records in this, as you know, as we say in the film, you know, his records go in the top drawer and Bobby Rydell and Pat Boone go on the top of the dresser drawer. You know, that kind of thing. You're dealing with all the institutionalized situation. And then to have his biggest record be My Ding-a-Ling must have been bizarre. You know, here's this guy writing genius stuff his whole life, and his biggest record is My Ding-a-Ling. You know, like, which he has no band on, anything, and which is, you know, another thing, having little girls singing that song. Kind of bizarre. So he just had to, you know, he started to, you know, oh, wow, that was really good. You know, that was good. Yeah, you are right. So, you know, the initial thing of him wanting to knock Keith out with a punch, you know, then punch back and goes, you're not so bad after all. You know, there was a lot of that. Going on, you know.
And then, you know, you mentioned Eric Clapton, and both of you guys have had quite a bit of involvement with him. He's another one who embraced you really early on, brought you out. Could you talk about how your relationship with him began and how that impacted and helped you musically and how it helped your career?
Yeah, at the early days of the Cray band, we started going to the UK in 84, I believe it was. And we started playing a lot of clubs, and we started to get a name in the UK, which was a big surprise to us. We had the album Bad Influence had come out, and that enabled us to go to the UK,
which has a heavy Memphis influence, I think, almost more than anything.
Yeah, there's a Memphis influence on it, and there's that song. That album had the song Phone Booth on it, and had the song Bad Influence that Eric had recorded the next year, actually in '85, I think, for the August, or it was the August album. And then we got this invitation to go on tour with Eric, I think it was like in 86. And the first of the dates was going to be at the Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland. And I'm sitting on the lip of the stage after sound check, and Claude Knobbs, the promoter, comes out from backstage with his cassette tape and tells me that I have a copy of your song Bad Influence. Eric just recorded. He just gave me a copy of it. So, and he handed me a tape, and then Eric comes out, and we sits down at the stage, and we start chatting. This is my first meeting with Eric, and that's when we started. Yeah.
Yeah, and you, Steve, have toured with him quite a bit, and you play when you and Willie Weeks, when you did those shows with him. The tour and then the Sandy thing, which you play so much more aggressively than other people who've played with him, and you push him so much harder, you guys as a rhythm section, than other people he plays with. And I'm wondering, like, does he say, I want someone to kick my ass, I'm going to go get Steve Jordan and Willie, or is there like an express, is that something that you ever discuss? Because the relationship you guys have with him as a rhythm section, it's totally different than what I've heard other people play with, who are all great, but totally different.
Well, when Eric, you know, first of all, Eric and I have known each other for a very long time, and we did jam together on, one time I invited him to play on the Letterman show, it's just sit in with the band, and at that time, the band was getting a lot of attention, and people weren't actually going to the show to be interviewed by David Letterman. They were kind of scared of David Letterman at that time, but they wanted to play with the band. So we were able to get a lot of people. I got friends like Eddie Van Halen just sat in with the band. We get all kinds of people sitting in. So we Eric came and sat in one night, played with us. It was a big deal. And then we played later on that night at a place that we used to take friends and play after the show. We'd just hang out all night and play. And that night at this particular studio, in the next room, Stevie Ray Vaughan was in the next room the night before his legendary Avery Fisher Hall show. So we're in this one room and we're jamming away. I think Danny Korchmar is with us, and you know, we're just jamming away and you know, Eric didn't really have a guitar, and, you know, so we had the studio guitar, and it wasn't really all that good. Eric wasn't really very happy. And then Stevie Ray was in the other room, and they had never met, so they brought Stevie Ray in to the room, and there was a grand meeting. That was the first time I met Stevie Ray, and it was really cool. You know, Dan, like I said, Danny Korchmar was there, and I think Paul Schaefer, and then Stevie Ray picked up that guitar, and a whole nother sound came out, and it was like, whoa, who is this guy? You know, and that was our introduction to Stevie Ray. You know, but I never had a chance to really have time to tour with Eric or anything because of our schedules, and also he always had great bands anyway, so it wasn't like it was, you know. But the opportunity finally presented itself where I was available, and I thought, well, it would be great to have this band be like kind of like Derek and the Dominoes type of feel, because Derek Trucks was playing, and it would be like almost like a reunion, like George Harrison kind of thing, because Billy Preston was alive, and I thought, well, this is going to be a dream come true to play with Billy Preston, Willie Weeks, you know. Eric is going to be really amazing. Unfortunately, Billy fell ill prior to the tour and passed while we were on tour, and so that was a major blow. But the main thing was to get a different thing that Eric had been doing for the last several years. Get back to some, you know, different material. I was asking, you know, can't we play songs like Domino songs, like Got to Get Better and all that stuff, you know, which he hadn't done in a long time.
Right, and it got to where you were playing like four or five Derek and Domino songs to open the show.
Yeah.
And I was like ecstatic. And then I was walking out of the show and I heard some guys talking, and they said, man, I don't even know any of those five songs. He played like five songs I never heard to start. So I guess everyone's having a different experience, yeah, at every show.
No, it was great. It was great for me, you know.
Robert, who were some of your main guitar influences? And I don't know if anyone else cares about this, but was Magic Sam a big guy for you?
Magic Sam was huge. Yeah, Magic Sam was huge. We used to do a lot of Magic Sam songs in the early days of the Cray Band when we did a lot of covers. Magic Sam, Otis Rush, Elmore James, even though I don't play slide, I loved his other stuff. We even put a little bit of a, we did an Elmore James song on one of the records we did, I think on Should Have Been Home.
Should Have Been Home, yeah.
But, Albert Collins is one of my favorites, because we used to, we worked with Albert a whole lot. BB, of course, Buddy Guy. I love Buddy Guy because he's like off the wall. Yeah.
You've always had such a like Strat sound, you know, so I was wondering if it was mostly Strat players.
Well, no, I've never really looked at it that way, because I liked, you know, just players, you know. And I used to play Gibsons for a while, and then I saw Phil Guy playing a Strat once at this club, playing through a super reverb, and he had the reverb cranked up. The best way I can describe the sound that I heard was like somebody throwing a rock across a frozen, thinly frozen lake. It was, and that was it. Nice. Got to get a Strat.
And it's good that you took his guitar tone instead of deciding to take his, maybe his hair tips. You know,
You're cold, man.
I was just looking at some pictures just last week.
You're cold.
But Phil was a great underrated player who sort of went under the radar, you know, because he never really got out of Chicago much, I don't think. But you know.
And this was in Eugene, Oregon, where I saw him. I was living there at the time when we started the band.
Well, since you mentioned Eugene, Oregon, how did you end up in being an Otis Day and the Nights in Animal House?
I was living in Eugene, Oregon, and we got off a gig at a club, and the lady came up and asked me if I wanted to be in a movie, and it's not a lot of movies being made in Eugene, Oregon, so I didn't take her seriously, but she persisted, and I gave her my info. Then, like a couple months later, I got a call, and we were in Northern California, and I said I could be back for Sunday night, and we got fitted, and I got my hair done. And we listened to the music that was pre-recorded and whatnot. And I borrowed the bass from Richard Cousins, our bass player, who to this day says he wasn't dark enough to be in the movie.
So who were the other guys? Were any of them
They
were musicians?
Sonny King, a great tenor, alto saxophonist, the saxophone player, who's the son of Saunders King, the blues musician. The singer Robert Bailey, who after he left Eugene, went on to join the PTL Club as one of the singers in that group, but now he sings with Winona, and he sings with all the big names.
He wasn't actually singing though at his day. Did he actually?
No. The stuff we listened. We listen to the music, the tape stuff, and that's Robert Bailey. He's playing the keyboard. He's going, yeah, that's him and doing that stuff. But no, we rehearsed the stuff. We rehearsed dance steps and all that.
I guess you never could have thought that this is something you'd be talking about 35 years later.
No, because when we were just, pickups, and we didn't know the working title, you know.
I'd heard that when they were filming at Belushi, used to come see you play a lot. And
we,
was Curtis Salgado.
Curtis Salgado had his band, the Nighthawks, and of course we had the Cray band. And on Monday nights at the Eugene Hotel, we'd have our splinter group that was called the Crayhawks. One Monday night, after we'd taken a break, and some fans in the audience said, "Hey, John Belushi's out there." We go, "Who the hell is John Belushi?" Because we always worked. We were a bar band. We worked on Saturday nights, you know. And then we got off stage and we met John. And then a little bit later on, he was invited up on stage. And he did his Joe Cocker impersonation. Then, because the movie was being made in Eugene over a period of a couple of months, Curtis was taking John back to his house and schooling John blues and playing a lot of records for him and whatnot. Curtis was the one who mentioned to John that Ray Charles plays alto saxophone. And then a little ways down the line, Ray Charles was on Saturday Night Live playing his alto saxophone. You know, things like that were happening, so that was pretty cool. And then, of course, Curtis wore the prescription Ray-Bans and had the little taint. And
blues patch.
Yeah, the blues patch.
John used to call it a blues patch.
And the thing I always remember is like the Blues Brothers' first show on Saturday Night Live had Paul Schaefer doing his Don Kirshner impersonation. And he goes, "And with the help of Kurt Salgado and the Cray Band, we give you the Blues Brothers."
Yeah. So the very first time the Blues Brothers were introduced, you got a shout out.
We got a shout out, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was really wild. You talk about full circle. So, hell, rock and roll. And, we were going, okay, so now we were all dressing, you know, like we dress, and you know, Chuck is in basic mid-70s polyester mode, with the string tie and the freaking jacket and the flares. And I'm thinking, we're playing this great original music from the 50s. He can't be up there looking like that. I mean, we got to do something about this. So we're thinking, I'm thinking, well, Keith, you can't be looking like the way you look either. We need to... We need to get a band uniform. You know, we need to, at the time, if we're going to be timed, you know, the period piece, you know, you know, the cast used to have suits, you know, shark skin suits, whatever, you know, we got to be tight, you know, get the groove going. So Keith heard me, and then we end up talking to Taylor Hackford, and he hired wardrobe, and so we're going to get these suits, right? So we get these suits. And lo and behold, they're the same suits that this dude wore in Animal House, you know, 20 years earlier. Like, this is like the only suits in Hollywood for bands or something. It was unbelievable. I'm like, these are the same suits. It's like, you know, wow. Unreal. But it's true.
We just made news. We just broke news here.
Hey. Yeah.
I think we're going to open it up to some questions from the floor. Is that what's happening, Brad? Yeah. We're good? Yeah.
I'd like to know who, hello, Robin, I'm Joe Malone from Jersey City. Who played your high school prom that influenced you?
Albert Collins played our high school.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And this is up in Tacoma, Washington. Albert had been playing a lot of shows around the area, but I don't know how the hell all these high school kids got to see him. I saw him at an outdoor concert, and I was listening to his music at that time anyway in high school. But our class had a choice between a group called Cray, who had a song called Evil Woman. It was on the top 40 hit or something like that. Albert Collins didn't. But our class voted for Albert Collins to play. And he played for us at Pacific Lutheran University in Tacoma, Washington. And he did like what Albert Collins did, walk through the crowd with his long guitar cable to all these 17 and 18 year old kids. It's fantastic. Yeah.
How you doing? It's an honor to be here with both of you. Question for both of you, since I can only ask one. If you had to pick one person, Robert, who was your biggest influence growing up, who would that be? And Steve, how did you get to be with Keith Richards and work with him over the years?
I can't say just one. It's just impossible because there's so many greats with so much to offer, you know, in all kinds of genres. It's, you know, and if I did tell you somebody, I'd walk out this door and there'd be like five others I could have told you. Yeah. I can't answer that one.
I got to work with Keith. The first time Keith did Saturday Night Live, the Stones did Saturday Night Live in the first show of season 4. And it was a real big deal. And there was a ton of security and the loose kind of feel of the show of people mingling and stuff was curtailed and everything because of about the security and it was the Stones and they didn't want people mingling and trying to get next to the guys and everything. So that bored me to tears. So I didn't hang around at all. And the priority for me was that the New York Yankees were playing the Kansas City Royals in the American League Championship Series, and that's all that was on my mind. So while everybody was trying to get close to the Stones, I was in what we call the Departure Lounge, which was the Saturday Night Live band dressing room. And the Departure Lounge, you can imagine why it was called that. And... so I'm up there watching the game, and then one thing leads to another, and like Charlie Watts rolls in, and so he says, "What's happening?" I said, "I'm watching the game, man. You want to check it out?" So we watch, and so he's sitting there, and there's just the two of us in the dressing room, And he says, oh, it's kind of like a combination of rounders and cricket. And I said, yeah, I guess so, yeah. And that's when Charlie and I became friends. So now, roll like several years later. Now, I had one experience with Keith right before then, after that, which was we had done, we were at the Blues Bar, and we were listening to the record, the new record, not the Briefcase Full of Blues record, but the Made in the USA record or something, Made in America record. And John was rocking the Blues Bar pretty hard, and Keith and Patty roll in, and Keith was in a certain mood, and so Danny was really excited to play the record for Keith, and Keith was listening to it, and he was like, sounds like a jazz drummer. Now, I thought that was an insult at the time. In retrospect, of course, I realized it wasn't really an insult because all Charlie Watts wants to be is a jazz drummer, and jazz is the basis of the art form anyway. But at the time, being a teenager, I thought he was trying to say I was playing too busy or whatever, I wasn't in the pocket or something like that. So I was like, you know, this dude, you know, what's up with this cat, you know? So then a couple years afterwards, I'm in Paris, I'm recording with Arcadia, which is a Duran Duran offshoot band, and with Simon Le Bon and Nick Rhodes. And so I'm playing, and Mark Egan and I are playing with them. And you know how road crews know each other. So there was a night off the following night, and the crews were going to get together, and the Stones crew reached out to Duran's crew or whatever. And they were going to be in the studio. So I sent a message to Charlie just to say hello. And Charlie invited me to the studio. And I went to try to find Pathé Marconi, EMI Studios, in Paris. And I spoke no French. And it was really, it was winter. And the cab driver took me to this address that I had written down and dumped me on the street in the suburbs there, and there were no call boxes or anything, and I was underdressed, and I didn't know what to do. I thought I was going to be arrested for loitering or something. I was very concerned, and it was, you know, kind of stressful. And then I said, what am I going to do? So I started to try to listen to hear some music, and I heard something faint. And I just followed the music. I went down this alleyway and blah, 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 blah. And the next thing you know, in the back in this yard or something, there's Pathé Marconi AMI. And I walk up, and there's a glass wall, glass doors. And I hear behind these doors the Rolling Stones. And I just started to cry, basically. I couldn't believe, first of all, I was freezing to death. Second of all, I found them, so I'm not going to go to jail. And then, so there's a little security guy comes up and he goes, bit, 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 and I say, yeah, the Rolling Stones, Steve, is, and he lets me in, you know, like, wow, high security, right? And so I get in and I walk in and I go in the control room and Dave Jordan is behind the board and I look in and the Stones are set up like they're playing live because that's how they record. And I just couldn't believe it because I'd never seen them play live before. And it was amazing, and I was in shock and tear, you know, like everything, every emotion was gone. And then they finished playing, and then I went out. And they let me into the room, and Ronnie was, hey, see, meet, you know, and Charlie was, oh yeah, and then Keith was, ah, you know, was like, yeah. And then that was it, you know, and that's when we hooked up, and. And then Mick didn't talk to me for like 5 hours until like the end of the night. Then all of a sudden, then I was his new best friend. It was the weirdest thing, you know, like he didn't talk to me for hours. And then all of a sudden it was like, ah. And then we started working the Stones with, and Ian Stewart was there. Ian Stewart, the original Stone. And so what would happen was Mick didn't go to the studio every night. He went every other night. And the guys would work every night. And then I would get a call from Ian Stewart, like, the boys need you tonight. And then I would go, And I would just not just play, I wouldn't play drums because Charlie wanted me to play drums sometimes, and I wouldn't play drums. I said, look, I'm a Stones fan. And like, I wouldn't, as a Stones fan, I would shoot Steve Jordan if he were playing the drums and you were alive and you're alive and he's, what am I playing? And no, you don't understand. I am not playing the drums. I'll play a little percussion. I sang some backgrounds. I even did mock lead vocals during those times when Mick, you know, wasn't there to get an idea out that Keith had or whatever. And that's how we started working together. And that's when I first heard him sing an octave lower on a tune called Get Some Sleep Tonight. Well, you gotta get some sleep tonight. And I thought, I'd never heard him sing down an octave. And I thought to myself, not knowing if I'd ever see this guy again, but if I ever got a chance to work with him, I would like him to do something in that register because it was so compelling. And that's what led to Make No Mistake on Talk Is Cheap. You know, that's the same register to the thing because that always stuck with me, you know, that sound. So that's basically how Keith and I, and I tell you what, when I first saw him on Ed Sullivan when I was 7, 8 years old, I never thought he'd end up being like my big brother, you know, and it's like the weirdest thing. Cause, and the other thing is, like, I'm a Beatle fanatic. So when we were writing music for Talk Is Cheap, which was right around the corner from my loft, I would want to take a bathroom break because I'm a very private person. And I couldn't and invite him over to my apartment because it was like a Beatle museum. And I thought, you know, I can't have him over. You know, this is like kind of weird. And, you know, it's like, you know, because, you know, when you're a kid, you think you're a Beatle fan or you're a Stones fan. You couldn't be both, you know. So I gave my loyalty to the Beatles. And so when I had him over, he just had a pretty good chuckle about the whole thing. And then for Christmas, he got me you remember those little statuettes of the Beatles, you know, that you see in Times Square? He got me a set of those for Christmas. And yeah.
But it's interesting you say you're a Beatles fan. Was Ringo Starr big?
Huge. A huge influence on my playing and everything else, actually. And I can say that I'm happy to know him. And so, yeah, but I was kind of schizophrenic. Miles Davis in one ear, Beatles in that ear, Sly Stone here, James Brown here, Stone, you know, like everything, you know, Art Blakey here, you know, that's Sly and the Family Stone there, you know, that's it was.
And that's reflective in your career. I mean, in order to be, you know, a great drummer, especially in something like the Letterman Band or the Saturday Night Live Band, you have to be able to play anything with anybody really well, right?
Well, that's New York. New York provides that background. You live in New York, you grow up in New York, and the school system, you know, before you know, the government started stripping away arts in public schools, and you grew up in New York, it was mandatory. You either went home the first day of school with a clarinet or a violin, okay? And you had to learn how to play an instrument, and it's very important to the formulation of a full personality to have some type of knowledge or endeavor in the arts. And that's what the New York City school system cultivated. And living in New York, being with all the great musicians, everybody was great. The chances of you getting out of here with some kind of accolade are not very high because everybody's great, you know. So you're not a big fish in a little pond. Everybody is great, and you're always, you see something every day that you go, wow, how is that person playing that? Or so I made a decision in my teens that I was going to play with everybody I possibly could to learn. You know, not to for anything else, but to experience all this great musicianship. And so that's the New York City story, you know, really.
All right, we're gonna do one more question. Brad's got the.
Okay, Robert, I asked you before your influences, but there has to be a time when you're a young. I don't know when you started playing guitar, but when something clicked in you that said, this is what I want to be? And do you remember that time in your life when you decided, this is what I want to do?
I think it was when I was first taking guitar lessons, and one of those Saturdays, the guitar teacher had his band come in, and there was a drummer, there was a bass player, and he played, and it just did something to me. It just like, wow, this is just fantastic. I you know, drummer was there, a real drum set, you know, and this whole sound, and I was standing right there next to these people, and they were playing music, and I think that's what did it. I don't think I've ever experienced music like that ever, and I'm in a band now, but no, the first time, I think that's what did it.
And I think, mm-hmm. Robert, you took it really seriously from the early on. If you listen to, you know, your early recordings, I mean, the first time I saw you was in 1985 or 86 in Rick's American Cafe in Ann Arbor. And I saw a lot of great music there. But you guys, you know, had a certain polish and, like, seriousness of intent that stood out.
We had fun. We had fun in the band because, you know, we played clubs. We'd play, you know, three or four nights a week. And you'd do three or four sets a night, 45-minute sets. So your book was huge. And since you did it all the time, and the kind of music that we wanted to play, which was a pretty good variety of music, if we were going to play a James Brown tune, we wanted it, you know, polished, you know, you wanted to be tight. So we started doing all this stuff, you know, and trying to segue from one song to the next, and put a little bit of show stuff into it, and but we you know, and we started using dynamics, you know, playing ballads, bringing songs down within the song, and you know, a lot of things that I think are overlooked, and you know, that's what we worked on.
Yeah, speaking of the dynamics, that's one thing about Robert when you see him play live, is his use of dynamics. Not many people do that anymore, and it's always thrilling for me when I see him play live to use that. And we kind of do that when we play with High Rhythm. We use all, you know, the range, you know, from triple piano to triple forte, you know. We can, and that's important, you know, and you don't get to hear everybody usually these days, everybody's playing at one volume and one speed, you know. And so we like to utilize the whole realm, you know, and he does that extremely well.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah. I think that wraps it up.
Thank you.
Hey, everybody.
Oh, we got one more question. What? No, but there's a really wonderful drummer named Terrence Clark playing with Robert. He's got a really new band. It's fantastic.
Let's hear it for Robert, Steve, and Alan Paul.
Thank you.
And thank you for everybody for tuning in Guitar World out there. Once again, the record is?
Robert Cray and High Rhythm on
fantastic
JV Records.
Record. Exactly. Thank you.